Hello, and welcome to the latest installment in our UXDX online series. I hope you're as excited as I am for the talks that we have coming up this evening. But before we jump into the talks, I want to give a very quick introduction to UXDX and why we host these sessions. So at UXDX, our mission is to help teams shift from building software using waterfall projects or water scrumfall and using empowered autonomous product teams. And the reason why that's our mission is because we believe it's a more effective, efficient, innovative, and sustainable way of building software products when you're in a high change environment. So if you're not really doing much changes, so let's say you build a project, finish it, and then move off somewhere else, then it makes sense to use a project team because you don't want to have people there continuously. But I've worked in companies where there's 150 plus projects going on at any given time. So there's always somebody touching some part of the product. And in that case, it makes sense to have people who really understand the customers, really understand the product needs from the business side, and can keep iterating and improving and make sure that the product really fits the needs for the customers. Now, that's really easy to say, but it's actually very hard to do in practice because it involves changing so many different things around the business. And that's where these talks come in. So no one talk is going to cover every piece of how you would do that change. We ask people to come and share how they're changing their ways of working and what they're doing to improve how they're building products. So hopefully as the talks go on, you'll be thinking about how you can apply that in your context. So if you do have questions, please feel free to ask them, whether it's in the chat box on uxdx.com or on YouTube, LinkedIn, Twitter, whichever platform you're watching this on, please feel free to enter those questions, and we'll put those questions through to the speakers. Now, sometimes we can't get through all the questions that come up in a session, and that's why we have the UXDX community Slack group. And in there, we have an Ask the Speakers channel. So any questions we don't have time to get through today, we'll put those questions in there, and we'll invite the speakers to come and answer them for you. But that's enough of an introduction. For me, you're not here to listen to me talk. So I would like to welcome Kremena to the stage, who will be talking about enabling the team and using UX frameworks for wide organization success. So, welcome, Kremena.
Hi, everyone, and thank you for joining. Today, we'll be talking about UX frameworks and different strategies that we use at VMware. I'm a senior UX manager there in the lead of our UX design team, and I really hope that today's session will be very productive and useful for you. I want to share VMware's colleague experience journey as we build our first employee-facing team in VMware with focus on technology enablement, process improvements, and future of work practices. It's a five-year journey that included many ups and downs, a lot of lessons learned, and a lot of different restructurings and strategy readjustments that aim to ensure this newly built colleague experience framework is effectively and efficiently supporting the cross-business unit and organizational success. Some of the topics we'll cover today: what is our approach to colleague experience at VMware? What are some of the domains that we have identified and created, and how we allocate resources accordingly? What is our organizational structure and how it's built to support this transformational effort that is happening within VMware, as well as some roles, responsibilities, and some different strategies around process and how we evaluate the impact of our work. First, I'll start very briefly with what employee experience is. By definition, this term encapsulates what people encounter and observe over the course of their tenure at an organization. Some professionals still think of employee and colleague experience as a term very specific to human resources, which for us is not true. Colleague experience for VMware is way more complex, and we define it as every employee touchpoint with technology, process, physical experience, policies, and even interactions with other employees. So how people collaborate synchronously or asynchronously, how they communicate, how they set up their home office stations, environments, etc. Those are all elements for colleague experience and input experience for us. And we believe that every colleague experience and even customer experience mature organization needs to tackle at a certain point of its journey. Data shows that investment in colleague experience has significant impact on innovation, customer satisfaction, and revenue. And with that, more and more companies are investing a lot of resources and realizing how great workplace experience impact their businesses. For VMware, as I already mentioned, this journey started about 5 years ago, and it started as an IT-oriented and IT-specific focused colleague experience team. Initially, the scope of our work was to create custom-built solutions for IT and engineers and to evaluate the technology experience at the company. Of course, this included improving productivity for IT teams, kind of, you know, automating a lot of the manual work that was happening. But it was, again, very IT specific and IT focused. As we got more traction and visibility across the company, our focus expanded and we began to engage in a lot of foundational research and design efforts that aim to support the business transformation that was happening across the company. And I'll talk a little bit about this in the following slides. In terms of our approach to colleague experience, we believe that this is the foundation in terms of why we're successful at this space, because this approach helps us ensure we're making data and research-driven decisions while also focusing on the human factor and empathy building across the company. We believe this is very important because we are a very big technology company. So for us, it's very easy to jump to technology and kind of let the technology dictate the solution instead of focusing on the actual need or problem we are trying to solve. So this is why we are very, we have a very colleague first mindset. We have empathy as our key driver and we leverage methodologies such as design thinking, for example. In terms of our structure, we are part of the Worldwide Operations Organization, which is a relatively newly built organization within VMware. We use a centralized organizational model where all UX team members report to a UX manager, and UX designers and researchers work on various products and efforts as needed, acting as consultants to the rest of the organization and the rest of the business units, because there are a lot of them, as you can imagine, for a 40,000 employee organization. The advantages that come with this structure are a lot. First, this agency model gives us a lot of visibility across many different areas of the business. And this, of course, increases not only how our work is perceived, but also the impact of our work, because we can actually contribute to different pieces of the puzzle. We have the opportunity to engage with senior leaders and influence decision in relation to all aspects of colleague experience, HR, IT, sales productivity, marketing, et cetera, et cetera. This inevitably impacts the team as we are provided with many different opportunities for growth within each space, domain, or even within different products. And of course, this also ensures our designers and researchers could be allocated to a project or a domain based on their expertise or their particular interest. VMware is in the midst of a company cultural transformation, and as we're currently being acquired by Broadcom, this is a very expensive deal. I assume some of you have heard about, hopefully most of you have heard about this. And we're also in the same time going through a subscription and SaaS transformation that predates the Broadcom acquisition news. So with all of those changes happening at the same time, a lot of challenges are coming our way, and we need to adjust and make sure we are operating in a way to support the different business transformation efforts that are happening across the business units. So for that reason, we have defined the so-called domains, or you can call them spaces. For us, those are HR, subscription and SaaS, commerce, experience, IT support and experience, future of work, and work practices, and our process-related activities. Of course, those processes are oriented around HR onboarding, et cetera. I'll briefly cover this as well. In terms of our HR and technology experience in the working out within that domain, our partners play a crucial role in enabling VMware leaders and employees to navigate successfully through VMware's transformation. And our goal there is to really provide timely and relevant solutions for our colleagues to drive business outcomes. And of course, this means not only streamlining different processes, but also automating a lot of the manual work and improving self-service and personalized experiences for HR staff and employees. In terms of our subscription and SaaS commerce experience, I would say that this is probably the biggest priority for our team and for the company right now. VMware is going faster to the future with an increased focus on moving the company and our customers and partners to a subscription model of working. This means that we are working with our product management and development partners, and of course our business partners, to simplify, standardize, and automate SaaS business processes, policies, and systems. And where our focus really is in implementing a holistic offer-to-cash ecosystem through research, UX strategy, and design support across all the different product spaces and slim ways within subscription and SaaS space. Of course, we are continuously supporting our IT partners by delivering new capabilities and improving existing experiences in relation to our ticketing system, intranet, chat support, and many more productivity-related solutions that we have within VMware. I already mentioned that colleague experience within VMware is uniquely set up in terms of the scope of our work. Our workplace and future of work efforts are one of those areas that are very interesting, and our research team is driving remarkable work there, ensuring that the company is adopting best activity-based working practices, remote work practices, as well as adopting new technology such as VR and AR, and we're exploring different use cases for those new technologies coming in. Of course, in terms of continuous improvement of our processes, this is a huge area of focus for us, and it is something that has continually impacted our colleagues' well-being, retention, and of course, indirectly impacting cost savings around improved productivity or the time needed for a new person to onboard. In order for us to effectively tackle the specific challenges for each domains, because as you saw, they're all very different and just very, very, very specific, we have designed a variety of different approaches and strategies and frameworks that we leverage in order to drive these transformational efforts. Our organizational structure is one of those strategies that we have, and how we allocate resources is, I would say, very, very unique. It's not definitely something that you haven't seen or won't be seeing in the future. But I would say that we have a very mature UX structure and very interesting way of allocating resources. Currently, we have 5 different subteams or different fields and expertises. We have UX strategy, UX operations, UX content and communications, UX design, and UX research. All designers, strategists, and researchers are embedded within different spaces. So for example, you can have a strategist, designer, and researcher working on subscription and SaaS domain or within an HR domain. UX strategy is a very interesting team. It is a relatively new one, and I'll speak a little bit about the role itself in a bit, but pretty much this team consists of experienced senior UX professionals that are problem space experts, and they oversee work for a specific domain or subdomain. And they help us better collaborate with our cross-functional stakeholders within that domain. Design operations or design ops, I assume this is a term that most of you are familiar with. This is a group that supports and works with our UX design and research managers to address different challenges in relation to workflows, processes, the quality and impact of our work, and also how we collaborate and align internally. UX content and communications and designing research, I assume those roles and teams are very straightforward in terms of responsibilities, but I'll again go over some of those in a bit. And what is even more interesting in how those roles collaborate together, which I feel like is an opportunity for a lot of companies to leverage and improve the quality of the work that is being delivered. Trying to change my slide. Okay, having a little bit of technical challenges here. Very briefly about the different roles that we have and how they differentiate, because I think there's a lot of value in how we define those roles and how they interact with each other. The UX strategist role is a relatively new role within VMware, and I would say in the UX field in general. This particular, it's an individual contributor role. So this is really a problem space expert focusing on discovering foundational work for a specific domain. The UX strategist engages and collaborates with product owners and product managers to plan and prioritize UX efforts within a domain space or a specific product within a domain. Those people lead strategy and vision conversations with product and even service owners in some instances, and manage stakeholder relationships within that space. Of course, they also work on things like prioritization, planning, documentation to ensure that the UX work is consistent and is embedded in the best way possible in terms of the product development lifecycle. The UX architect role, it's a role that is very similar to the UX strategist role, and I believe in some companies, it might even be the same role. Within VMware, however, the UX architect role is a more of a strategic role in terms of end-to-end experience within a domain. So this person actually is engaged across all related domain spaces and products to ensure there is a holistic approach to the problem solving in terms of solutions, research, approach, etc. They work directly with leadership and decision makers to get buy-in and to ensure UX practices are supported across the business and from the top down. And much like the strategists, architects work to ensure UX is embedded and processes are followed by the product management and development group, but more at the high level end. UX and UX design and research managers, those are people manager roles. I don't think there are, you know, any big differences in terms of what UX design and research managers do within VMware. But for us, a big focus for these roles is ensuring that there is alignment between the company objectives, the business objectives, and also our internal efforts, and what are the different work that is being delivered and how it connects to the wider picture, pretty much. Of course, those people are leading hiring, onboarding, skill diversification for the design and research team, and are allocating resources accordingly based on expertise, interest, and bandwidth. The UX subject matter experts is another role that we have defined within VMware as a way to enable our team members to grow in a way that they don't feel obligated to become people managers, because I think this is a struggle in our community. In order to grow, you have to become a manager, which is not true for our colleague experience team at VMware. And the UX subject matter experts or leads are usually domain experts or field experts that focus on very specific methodology, or they're very engaged in a specific UX, let's say, field or focus area. For example, UX accessibility lead, mobile experience lead, UX discovery lead. They deliver a variety of materials and are responsible to ensure consistency and quality across the different spaces, domains, and products. And some of the common activities that they engage in is creating different knowledge sharing sessions, documentations, enablement materials, etc. The design operations lead, I already briefly talked about this, but those are professionals that continuously support the wider design and research group to improve workflows, processes, and to ensure collaboration and alignment practices are followed. they work on asset management, enabling our team in terms of tool sets, and of course, even communicating some of our success stories alongside our UX design and research managers. And UX designers, UX researchers, and UX content specialists, I think those are very straightforward. And what is interesting or different, I would say, for our research group is the fact that our researchers are very heavily focused on foundational research, which means complex research activities that aim to map the end-to-end experience and the very complex ecosystem within VMware. So you will rarely see our researchers actually conduct usability testing. This is something that usually a lot of our UX designers also do. But of course, our research team is continuously supporting those efforts as well. Some of the cons that come with our structure and how we operate and how are we tackling those challenges. Of course, within VMware, we have a lot of different efforts, but with that comes a lot of inconsistency and a lot of alignment challenges, both internally for our team, but also cross-functionally and cross-business unit, in a cross-business unit aspect. To fight this alignment and standard challenges, we have created a unified UX process that we apply consistently across the different domains and product spaces. And I will walk you through that process. And what is very interesting is how UX strategy, UX design, and UX research actually work together within that process. We have things like a shared repository, design system, libraries with assets such as icons, images, non-standard UI components that are not necessarily part of our design system, as well as clearly defined quality standards and UX checklists. And all of those different strategies and tools really help us stay aligned, even though in some instances we might not be constantly communicating with each other, meaning HR designers and research or researchers within the HR domain might not be actively engaging with the researchers and designers across the subscription and SaaS domain. We also have a lot of design rituals. We invest a lot of time on team enablement, knowledge sharing sessions, and different syncs, or even our UX review meeting that runs weekly, where all teammates can present their work and receive design critique and feedback, as well as quarterly retrospectives where we reflect on work challenges we've had during the past 3 months. And we use that time to really iterate on our goals, but to also create better focus for the team moving forward. Another con that comes with our structure is slow growth for individuals. And I think this is true for most complex environments where you have very diverse type of products or projects or domains. Thankfully, we've been lucky enough and thoughtful enough to create very straightforward professional level requirements, individual development plans, and specialization options. The UX subject matter expert is one of those specialization options that really allows our individual contributors to grow as individual contributors, as experts, instead of them feeling obligated to go into a management track. We also support our teammates by providing regular career conversations and executing skill set diversification exercises. This is both on individual level, but also on team level to make sure that we're informing our hiring strategy as well. Last but not least, bureaucracy. And I think this is part of each large enterprise, especially enterprises that are going through big transformations where they're trying to change the mindset and the culture. And VMware is no different. Even though we are an innovation-driven company and very technical-savvy company for a 40,000 employee organization, we have many levels of management and leadership to support the different functional groups. This means that we need to be mindful of that, and we need to be very flexible in order to accommodate for the different needs and use cases within each business unit. And we also need to apply tactical approaches and strategies, but also keep in mind our long-term vision as our North Star. Moving forward with our colleague experience process map, I mentioned that our process is one of our strategies that we leverage to ensure high quality of our work and consistency across the different products and domains. Our process, I would say, is quite standard. We start with a discovery phase, and then we move to opportunity framing, ideation, validation, and those are very, I would say, broken down into very like detailed and smaller phases, just to make sure we are consistently communicating with our cross-functional collaborators, and they really understand what is happening within each stage of the process. As I mentioned, what is interesting is how UX research, UX strategy, and UX design come together to support the end-to-end UX process with a narrow view and scope at different stages, but also ensuring that those different fields are aligned throughout the whole process. So UX strategy is highly engaged in the initial discovery and opportunity framing phases, as well as the MVP definition and prioritization work that is happening with the product management and development group. After that, they take on more of a governance and alignment role to ensure that the work that is being delivered is kind of meeting the initial requirements that were defined, and that it's meeting our quality standards as well. And of course, that we're solving the right problem. UX research supports UX strategy in the early process with a lot of explorational research, hypothesis definition of product personas, etc. And after that, they support the design group at the later stages with some usability testing, validation, and variety of different methods and frameworks to gather feedback and user sentiment. Design starts actively contributing at the ideation phase and is engaged throughout the whole process, and of course, continuously working with an iterative approach to deliver new functionalities and improve the already built experiences for the specific tool. Moving forward with our evaluation framework, which is also something that I would say is very unique about colleague experience at VMware. And I think this is an approach that can be leveraged not only for colleague experience teams, but also for product organizations as well. We have four different frameworks that allow us to have a very holistic view of the work that is being delivered and what is the impact for our colleagues and for the business. Starting with a technology experience survey, or as we call it, TES. It is a biannual survey on technology satisfaction that serves as a post-check on perceived value and sentiment on IT, business, meaning sales, HR, et cetera, and other internal tools and systems and processes within VMware. TES really shows the overall sentiment view at the categorical level, which means that we don't really have data that is showing what application or system or process is driving a specific result. And it's really an overarching measurement of colleague experience health for us. Whereas the next framework, which is our experience scorecard, the experience scorecard is focused on a specific application. This is a custom-built evaluation framework that was designed by our research team. And it really focuses on several different key evaluation variables. When considered together, they inform a robust and comprehensive view and evaluation of the specific product or system we're evaluating. This method really leverages a lot of different methodologies, such as user feedback, observation, analytics, in tandem of each other to create a cohesive data narrative to measure the UX success of the specific product. And I would say it's very customizable, so it can ensure that we can meet our specific domains and specific product use cases and needs. The foundational research work that our research team delivers consistently, and this is an ongoing effort for us, it's not really project or product driven, Here we use qualitative and quantitative research methodologies to understand and map complex business and service ecosystems to identify different challenges within those ecosystems and to ensure that we're informed and also our partners are informed about any process frictions that impact colleague productivity or the business success within the different domains. This is my opinion, is where our strength really lies, because this really allows us to look at our VMware ecosystem holistically and understand the deep underlying issues that decrease the colleague productivity and hurts the business operations. In terms of tracking our impact and kind of mapping our work to the organizational objectives, we have adopted the objectives and key results methodology, and we can probably have a separate discussion around that, because how OKRs are applied for UX is a very interesting topic to me. But OKRs really allow us to understand how our work connects to the bigger picture. This evaluation frameworks ensure that we have transparency and accountability across the different UX fields and across the different domains. And also they help us to, keep us honest and unbiased as we deliver and measure experiences across the different business units for VMware. Because it's very easy to become biased as UX designers, as UX researchers. We need to ensure that we have objective way to measure the success of our work. And to kind of wrap up the session today, I want to speak a little bit about the impact of our work and how the frameworks and approaches that we discussed today have successfully helped us transform how solutions both in terms of technology, by the way, and in terms of process, are being delivered within VMware. Before adopting a human-centered design approach, the organization really struggled with cumbersome evaluation of internal tools and processes, and there were a lot of organizational silos and inconsistent approach to problem solving in general. Research and data were very fragmented and not leveraged in any way, shape, or form. And dialogue between the different business units was lacking. As we applied our UX strategy, framework, foundational research, and focused a lot on different UX maturity and UX awareness efforts, we were able to really build a horizontal view and end-to-end holistic approach in terms of how colleague experiencing is delivered at VMware. We now have a multi-layered experience framework. We have very, improved dialogue and cross-team and cross-business unit collaboration that is happening. And we also have a multi-layered experience framework that helps us solve very complex business challenges for our colleagues and for our partners that help us deliver on our business goals as a company. Of course, a lot of that work is impacting well-being of our colleagues, job satisfaction and retention, as well as cost savings in relation to the increased productivity we provide to our colleagues. I really hope that all of this information will be helpful for you as you try to improve colleague experiences or even experiences with your product at your company, and I'll be happy to answer any questions that came up during the conversation.
So thank you very much, Kremena. That was really interesting for me because usually you think of UX as being the end customer focus. So it's really interesting to look at it from the angle of being internally focused. So thank you for sharing that. There people might be typing in their questions right now, but we have run over time. So I have one or two questions that I'd love to ask you, and I'll put them into the Slack channel that I've invited you to. So if you could answer them in there, that would be fantastic.
Absolutely. Thank you so much.
But thank you very much for sharing. Excellent. So up next, we have Mirela Moose, who will be talking about blazing fast onboarding for product managers. And I'm really interested in this one as well, because I know how long and how difficult it can be to get people up to speed. So I'd like to welcome Mirela to the stage.
Hey, thank you so much for this. I'm really excited to be here.
If you can just start sharing your screen, we can get going.
Absolutely. We are.
Great. Over to you. Thank you very much.
Cool. So it's blazing fast onboarding if you are joining the company. And for people who are line managers here, how to not freak out your new hires in their first week, because I think this is also going both ways. All right. So the outline would be, what is onboarding and why is this hard as a product manager? Ideal scenario, and which is of course not necessarily happening in practice. For product managers, how can you onboard and deliver value in 2 weeks? For companies, how to not freak out your new joiners, and a summary of this. First, a little bit about myself and how did I come to this insight. So I'm the founder of Product People. We're a 41 people company doing interim product management as a service. And through our engagements with our clients, which are about 100 or something per year, we onboard as often as 3 months within a new company on a new assignment. So we've come up with certain observations and tactics that help us ramp up in about 2 weeks and start delivering value, because as contractors, we don't have a lot of time given to us by our clients compared to regular employees. So through Product People, I've supported Zalando, Tier Mobility, Scout24, the World Health Organization, and a few other incredibly exciting companies. I also give back to the founders and the startup scene within Berlin and in general in Europe by mentoring at Techstars, Founder Institute, Intel Ignite, and a few others. So now about Product People, I talked a bit about our interim product management services. We also have something that we give out for free. So similar to this community, we have a product management community of about 20,000 people. You see all our talks are live streamed on YouTube every Tuesday. And we invite very insightful product leaders to share their knowledge generously with the world. And that is all for free. So there's like no marketing. You don't need to put your email and get upsold to some course or anything like that. It's just giving back to the community and making it better. And the way we make money, of course, is through our interim product management services. Sometimes we also do product ops at our clients or product leadership. For example, this is our colorful and lovely team. And some stats about us, where we have 200 cross-functional teams supported in different engagements, and about 70 plus clients from Series A to publicly listed companies, large amount of those being digital first and or product centric. We have our team in-house and full-time on our payroll, so we're not a recruiting company, we're not a marketplace, and it's all product managers. Well, we're also very proud to have 60% women in our team, including 66 in leadership. All right, so now to the gist of this talk. What is onboarding and why is this hard as a PM? First, onboarding. If you're interested about the topic in general and also other tips, I would recommend The First 90 Days by Michael Watkins. This chart is from the book where an employee is considered to reach a break-even point at 6 months. So in the first 3 months, they're considered that they take value from the organization, and then they start slowly giving that value back within their next 3 months. Of course, what I mentioned earlier, sometimes our engagements are 3 months tops because, for example, an employee leaves the company and it takes 3 to 6 months to hire a new product manager while we fill that gap for them. So for us, we need to onboard incredibly fast because in 3 months, we may be already out. So we need to have delivered something for our time there and serve the purpose and achieve an outcome. Aside from the part of onboarding fast being hard, it's even harder for a product manager for these five reasons. We have a huge surface area touching business, tech, operations. We invest everyone else's time. So if a product manager starts telling you some or pointing you or the development team or someone else in a direction that is not useful, then they haven't just wasted their time. They've also wasted the whole team's time and potentially missed out on an opportunity that would have 10x'd this time investment. They also make or break the information flow. So you see sometimes when you have a very good product manager, they can go in a completely confusing meeting or situation and come out sorting everyone out of that. Whereas one that is less competent will just manage to confuse everyone even in a very normal, clear setting. In some cases, they also need extensive domain knowledge, which we also have in our company through the engagements we did with fintech and medtech clients, as it's a heavily regulated industry. So there are some things that are unintuitive, but you need to do there. And of course, PMs also need to understand the strategic context and how they're doing contributes to the top line or other goals the company has. And how do you measure that a product manager is doing well? Also, three ways. You look at the outcomes they help drive, you look at the processes they set up or follow along the way, and at the speed on which they impact the above. Because you can, of course, do something very well if you spend a lot of time on it, and many times in our cases, you don't have a lot of times and you need relatively fast reactions in a lot of situations. It's also worth pointing out that the initial context matters. So if we notice that when we join a company that's very well established and has a very good functioning product department that's large and stable and has developed very well on its own, then it's harder to make an initial impact because there's no fire to put out. There's no necessary some people unorganized and running around as headless chicken, or there's nothing super unclear to clarify at that moment and get everyone going. So most of the outcomes we achieve there are kind of effect of what was established before. And you can see in these setups that a new PM is helpful if at least they carry on with the business as usual. Of course, starts adding to the day-to-day. You know, this process was good. Are they making it better? They're following this, but are they also improving or contributing to do a little bit more than just being a cog in the machine? It's less visible from the get-go, but you can also then start seeing who is the driver there and who's making a hard impact. If, of course, then the situation we get brought in is it's completely chaotic, and the product team has been left by itself for 3 months and everyone is confused, including stakeholders and development team, then that's pretty easy to fix because just by bringing in a little bit of structure and leadership, everyone is more relaxed and happy and you start making some progress with that initially, even in the first few days, and you can secure a lot of quick wins. But of course, you don't necessarily want to end up in those places because it's probably not the only thing that is not working out. All right. In most companies or everyone, right, in their ideal scenario, they would like an employee to deliver value before they join. One of the cool examples we have from the movie called The Founder, I will recommend watching at least a few of the scenes on YouTube. One of them is with Harry Sonnenborn, the consultant that the McDonald's founder ends up hiring, where he reviews their data and discovers a problem with their business model and proposes a change that is credited to have made McDonald's the world-spanning corporation that it is today, basically by buying real estate and then using that real estate as leverage for more loans and expansion, but at the same time, being able to drive out the operators that don't abide to compliance standards. And that was the whole problem they had before. They didn't have enough cash for expansion, and operators sometimes didn't abide by their quality and brand standards, but couldn't be also forced to do it with stronger incentives. I'm not sure if this works. Let's see.
You have a minuscule revenue stream, no cash reserves, and an albatross of a contract that requires you to go through a slow approval process to enact changes, if they're approved at all, which they never are. Am I missing anything?
That about sums it up.
Tell me about the land.
The land.
The land, the buildings, how that whole aspect of it works.
Oh, pretty simple, really. Franchisee finds a piece of land he likes, gets a lease, usually 20 years, takes our construction loan, throws up a building, and off he goes.
So the operator selects the site.
Yeah.
He picks the property.
Right.
You provide the training, the system, the operational know-how, and he is responsible for the rest.
Is there a problem?
A big one. You don't seem to realize what business you're in. You're not in the burger business. You're in the real estate business. You don't build an empire off a 1.4% cut of a 15-cent hamburger. You build it by owning the land upon which that burger is cooked. What you ought to be doing is buying up plots of land, then turning around and leasing said plots to franchisees, who, as a condition of their deal, should be permitted to lease from you and you alone. This will provide you with two things. One, a steady upfront revenue stream. Money flows in before the first stake is in the ground. Two, greater capital for expansion, which in turn fuels further land acquisition, which in turn fuels further expansion, and so on, and so on. Land.
All right. So I will continue with this. Hope the sound was good. In the end, with product management, it deals with people and problems. So whenever you are in a new location or in a new company, you can look at first what are the people, mapping those people, and what are the main problems you should be dealing with at that time. For people, you can there are different tactics to do it. The simplest is mapping them, who is your champion or boss, who are your stakeholders, peers, and potential troublemakers. People most of the time want to focus on troublemakers, so this could be political opinions of your champion, opponents of your champion or boss, keyboard warriors, disgruntled employees, and you need, when you're new there, to preempt potential frictions that you may encounter from this category. And then for the other ones, they're relatively obvious things you can do to make it work. Visibility is also a key factor for a PM, so figure out what that means in your context and do it. And of course, I cannot stress enough the communication and being proactive with those to be known and be in the flow there whenever something comes up that pertains to your topic. Going to the problems, this could be the problem space, certain issues the company or the product is having, or the opportunity space that you're in. I would suggest in the beginning, figure out what your main quest, so what is success in your first 2 weeks, 1 month, 3 months over there, and start making a strong start on that, and get into side quests only after you feel you're on a good track with it. If this quest changes, if priorities are bound to change many times, then reassess and restart from this goal. This will also prevent you from getting overwhelmed, because as a PM, you get pulled in all the directions. There's a lot to be discussed on the product context, understanding like what's the job that your company exists to solve, where are you at in the product journey, or what are the customer choosing if you're not choosing your product. So this is also a topic on its own, but you should get a very good feel what you're doing, for whom, how successful you are, who is paying and why, and so on. Another part that's relatively underrated and under-discussed is that the company culture can hinder you or enable you a lot. So understand how things are done there. How can you operate properly? How do people act when their boss is not around? How does the communication go? What other anecdotal stories come from the past that you can understand, help you navigate the organization very well? You know, what are the real rules versus the what they say the rules are? And of course, especially in these times, how does the market look like? As we've all seen in the current months, with market shifting drastically, that also makes founders and CEOs pivot strategies and wind down different product lines relatively abruptly compared to in the last 2 years when there was a growth at all cost narrative. All right. So for companies, it's actually the same, but in reverse. Understand who your new hire should meet. What are the expectations you're setting for them? Consider having a one pager with these expectations so that they have something to go back through, and create a few documents. Consider an onboarding document with all the relevant links, info, and people so that you can give them that to run through in their first days there. Not necessarily just the HR one. I've noticed a lot of people get something from human resources that's broad and generic, but something that's exactly for the product they'll be running or their team or squad they would be on. And then I suggest in the beginning having recurring meetings with them, maybe even small daily check-ins, depending on how fast the person is getting up to speed, move those to weekly or every 2 weeks. All right, so we're down with the summary. By the way, this deck is also available online afterwards. So I also have a Medium article with the same title, so you can go and check it out anytime. So as a new joiner, find the people and problems pertaining to your scope, secure a few meaningful early wins, and build credibility so that you can have larger wins, get more context of how things work, and a few feedback sessions. After you gain trust, you can move towards riskier propositions or more strategic goals. And as a company, help your new joiner figure out the right people, the key problems you expect them to handle, send onboarding expectations and follow up on those, and agree on the winning early wins that they can deliver to help them gain trust and credibility, and for you to also get a sense of how they're working, how they're reacting whenever they have a certain setback, and so on. So thank you so much for listening.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Mirela. That was kind of, I guess it's nice just to put it into words what people are often, they're just kind of, here's your pass and your computer and good luck.
See you at the performance review, right?
Exactly. So if anybody has any questions, please do post them in. So Ivan has posted in just congratulating you on the share of women in your organization. So Ivan's obviously impressed. But yeah, so I'll kick off the questions, but if anybody does have any questions, please do post them in as well. One thing I was thinking of is it's kind of, I could put down, and I'm trying to picture myself when I was joining a place, somebody shared with me the people, but it still took a long time for me to get into their diaries, to meet them, to really understand what each person was needing. How do you think you can short circuit that? Is that a document type thing as well? Or is there another way?
Yeah, I've actually done, there's a way. So you can, for example, force the new person to reach out and meet with new people. At Product People, it's a bit of a self-guided thing. So in their onboarding document, people are encouraged to set 10-15 minute coffee chats. And we had someone who in their first week just like went ahead, had coffee chats with everyone. We've had a few people in a row, and there are others, you kind of see them in their second month, they're still going through the list. Us being a consultancy, we definitely give points to the people who do the coffee chats to begin with, because then they're also most likely not allocated on a client, so they have their calendar way freer than they will have once they get onboarded and ramped up on client work. Another part, I've seen it done well at Zalando, where I've had the pleasure to work with Lucy McLean. She had a team assistant book this intro session, so I was joining to help on a parental cover there on a applied science, working with an applied science team and a few others. And that's basically, this is the list of people you should meet, and the assistant had already scheduled all the intro meetings. There was also one pager of what were the expectations for this role, because being short-term and Zalando being a very large company, they wanted to get a sense of progress and not have someone start chasing five things. So that helped me in the conversation. Hey, I'm here during this amount of time to work on these three topics, and this is what we'll be talking about. And it was very easy, because then they will say, yeah, this is my input from this topic, or I prepared this proposal, can you review it? Or I have these ideas, can we look at them, and so on.
Great. That sounds perfect if the company is kind of set up, like as you just explained there with Zalando. What advice would you give somebody if the company isn't quite so kind of forthcoming with it? How do they find their quest and make sure that they don't inadvertently pick a side quest as their main one because they haven't learned enough yet?
Yeah, I mean, ask the line manager or whoever is responsible for appraising your performance. So, sometimes there's also this ambiguous part where there's a line manager, but the day-to-day work is done with other people. So I would say first, see around from the people responsible for you, and that will then be appraising your performance, right? Because that will also impact promotions or even tenure within the job. And then start from there. And if you get conflicting requests, then put those together and say, hey, this person said this person said that. Here's my take on it, or here's how I would propose prioritizing it. Let me know if it's fine for you, and so on. So it can be tricky sometimes, especially for PMs, because one can go and let's say their head of product says this, then they talk with the CEO says that. But then this will be also on the person to say, hey, here's all the info I've gathered from people. Here's my take on it. And do you approve or not in the beginning? And then take it from there based on how the initial experiences work.
Excellent. That's some great advice. Ivan's actually asked another question. So he's saying, do you have some experience with people who worked in one industry, for example, a product marketing in telecoms or FMCG, and they switched to a SaaS industry? So I guess it's just people who are moving industries, so a lot of their experience might not be as relevant. So what were the main challenges for the PMs and for you as their manager?
So is the question more, was someone was in a less digital industry and now they're moving on to a digital first product? Because I have a lot of skepticism about the whole industry part, just because they're seeing it at clients. What I think the observation is, indeed, it was a company where it was a bit more focused on physical or other type of work. So it's not a digital first company for whatever reason. The other part is the size and type of customer they're service. So B2C customers are a bit different than B2B. So if you're a B2B business of, let's say, series A, B, C, then you're going to be operating different than a B2C. So there's this combo of what type of customer they're serving and then what size are they at, plus the flavor of more traditional versus digital first companies.
So Ivan's clarified.
Ivan's
clarified saying it's that traditional to a more digital. So what are the kind of the challenges there, or do you have any advice?
Understand what's the pace of the company and what they really value. We notice people being slow also at digital first companies, right? Because that's I would be my first assumption. Yeah, everything moves super slow here, or is very political and so on. It can be slow and political everywhere else. It may just seem like things are moving, but then when you look at it from month over month, it's not a lot that's happening. Maybe language could be different. So kind of old school companies are super excited about agile, whereas the more modern ones are talking about product-led growth and experimentation. But again, that's more of updating your vocabulary. They may all also mean the same thing, right? So think from first principles, understand what's the problem there, what are you actually discussing aside, and don't get intimidated because like someone threw some keywords at you. Try to get the point.
Excellent. Well, I think that brings us up to time. So I think that was some really useful advice, and I hope that was useful for you, Ivan, as well as everybody else who's watching. So thank you, Mirela, for sharing.
Amazing. Thank you for inviting me.
Excellent. So that brings us to the end for today. But if you did enjoy the talks, please do consider joining us at our one of our main conferences of the year, which is UXDX USA, which is happening in New York between May 16th and 18th. We'll have 25 speakers on stage. There'll be 8 workshops, 500 people of your peers, so across product, UX, design, and dev, who will be there kind of just trying to learn different ways of improving how they work. So if you were interested in the talks today, it's going to be like that, but just much larger. Anyway, otherwise, if I don't see you there, I look forward to seeing you at the next UXDX online event.